I'm Jim Baxter, and this is a lecture on predator-prey dynamics for general ecology. By the end of this lecture, you should be able to describe how predators and prey fluctuate in regular cycles, explain how the Lotka-Volterra model predicts predator-prey cycles, and explain how a predator's functional and numerical response to prey can help stabilize predator-prey cycles. Last time we talked about how predators and herbivores can limit the size of populations, and how predation and herbivory favor the evolution of defenses. In this lecture, we're going to explore how predators and prey, through their mutual influence on one another, can affect each other's population dynamics. Let's start with an example. In the 19th and early 20th century, the Hudson's Bay Company kept quite detailed records on the numbers of animal pelts, that is, furs, that it purchased from trappers each year over a large area in Canada, Scandinavia, and Siberia. Their records, in fact, covered a nearly 100-year period, which is quite an extensive record of pelts that were purchased. In 1924, Charles Elton, who was an early ecologist, discovered and studied this data set quite extensively. Elton assumed that the number of pelts reflected the abundance of species on the ground. In particular, he examined two species, the Canadian lynx and the snowshoe hare, and those are depicted here in the picture. When he plotted the presumed abundance of these two species, he observed a remarkable pattern in their population sizes. Incredibly, the snowshoe hare and the Canadian lynx showed approximately 10-year regular cycles of abundance. There were several hypotheses proposed to explain this pattern. In fact, Elton himself thought it was related to the 9 to 13-year cycle of sunspots, which presumably influenced the climate and therefore the growth of the hare's food source, in other words, plant production. Others, however, proposed that the lynx predation that was observed was lynx predation was responsible for the pattern. Well, clearly an experiment was needed, right, to determine this. It wasn't until recently that ecologists conducted a series of large-scale experiments in which they added food for the hares and or excluded lynxes from large areas. This is when they started to get some answers. Interestingly, although increased food and decreased predation by lynx increased hare populations, the hare populations still cycled. That is, it still declined even though food was available and predation was low. In fact, whether or not food was plentiful, the hare population still declined. So this meant that there was something going on with hare reproduction. In other words, it declined even with food available and without direct predation. Surprisingly, in 2009, researchers discovered that lower reproduction in the hares at high hare densities was caused by high predator densities. High predator densities were observed to cause high levels of stress in the hares, which were responsible for a decline in their reproductive output. When the hare populations declined to a low enough level and there were fewer predators, hare reproduction returned to normal. So although food can influence the abundance of hares, a combination of direct predation and indirect effects of predator stress on hare reproduction was considered to play a significant role in giving rise to this pretty striking lynx-hare cycle. Building on this idea, scientists became interested in using pathogens as a way to biologically control pest populations in agricultural crops and forests. Carl Huffaker was a scientist at UC Berkeley who studied predator-prey cycles. In fact, he was an early pioneer in the science of biological pest control. To understand predator-prey dynamics, he studied the conditions that allowed predator and prey populations to fluctuate. In a classic study, he examined the interaction of the predatory mite, Typhlodromus occidentalis, on the left, with the phytophagus, that is, plant-eating mite, on the right, the Eotentrachus sex maculatus. Not sure if I'm saying that correctly, but in short, the six-spotted mite, that's the phytophagus mite. The phytophagus mite feeds on citrus, and the predatory mite feeds on the phytophagus mite as its prey. Huffaker wanted to know whether a large and complex enough laboratory environment could be set up in which he could get the predator and prey mites to coexist with one another without going extinct. His experimental setup was, well, unusual, you might say, but ingenious at the same time. He constructed a large table with oranges, shown, guess what, in orange, in the image, which was the food source for the phytophagus mite. And he interspersed these oranges with inedible rubber balls of the same size in between them. When the phytophagus mite was introduced into the array without the predator, the population of phytophagus mites grew and leveled off, indicating that the prey mite had sufficient resources and was able to persist. So without the predator, the prey was able to persist in this experimental array. So he was able to demonstrate that very clearly. But when the predatory mite was introduced into the system with the prey mite, the predatory mite increased rapidly and subsequently caused the prey to go extinct. With its prey depleted, the predator also went extinct. Though when the oranges, however, were spread out farther from one another, because Huffaker adjusted sort of the arrangement of the oranges, when the oranges were farther from one another, he noticed that it took longer for the predators to locate the prey on their food source. However, even despite that, both species still went extinct. It wasn't until Huffaker introduced an impediment to predator movement and facilitated prey dispersal that he was able to get the predator and prey to persist. Because predator mites disperse by walking, he actually spread Vaseline in a maze-like pattern between the oranges so that it would form a barrier to their movement, and for the predator movement, that is, and slow them down in their ability to find the prey mites on the oranges. Prey mites produce silken threads and that catch the wind and facilitate their dispersal. So Huffaker, knowing this, introduced wooden pegs into his experimental array to give the prey mites a launching off point so they could disperse more easily to other oranges. After he introduced the barriers, the Vaseline barriers and wooden pegs, the predator and prey mites actually were able to persist in cycles over an 8-month period. And that's shown here in the graph below. You can see that they cycled over a period of a couple hundred days in 3 different cycles. During the 8-month period, the predators and prey continually shifted as shown in the grids above the graph. As they went locally extinct on one orange, the prey that is, they would recolonize another. In this way, the prey were able to stay just kind of one step ahead of the predatory mite. In other words, the predator would eventually find the prey, but in the meantime, the prey could find new patches to occupy, that had not yet been discovered by the predator. So with the added barriers to predator movement and the prey dispersal being facilitated by these wooden pegs, Huffaker was able to create an experimental condition in which he could create persistence of both the predator and prey in these cycles. So given this kind of, movement, this spatial arrangement of these oranges as habitat for the prey that were colonized, maybe would become locally extinct and then recolonized by the prey, essentially, what kind of population model does this sound like for the prey mite? I'll give you a second to think about that. If you answered metapopulation, that's right. Prey mites colonize the oranges. They go extinct locally on those oranges and then recolonize them. Those oranges are in patches that are interspersed in a matrix of unsuitable rubber balls. So hopefully this sounds familiar to you in terms of the metapopulation model that we discussed recently. So Huffaker's experiment shows us that predator and prey populations can coexist and be persistent in cycles that can occur as long as the environment has a mosaic or a patchwork of suitable habitat patches for the prey, and that the environment is complex enough so that predators can't, quickly and easily find prey and cause them to go extinct. Let's turn now to how we model predator population, predator-prey cycles. To better understand predator-prey population dynamics quantitatively, Lotka and later Volterra developed and validated a model based on what we've learned already, the logistic population growth equation. To account for both predators and prey, the Lotka-Volterra model incorporates two growth equations, one for the predator and the other for the prey. So it's based on the logistic equation shown here, and we've discussed this. And of course, the logistic equation, and I think we've gone over this, has both a growth term and a damping term. So as we'll see, just like in the logistic growth equation, each growth equation, one for the predator, the other for the prey, also has an exponential growth term and a damping term. So we have separate predator and prey equations that work together in an interactive way. So let's start with the prey model. So that's shown here. We'll use n prey to indicate the prey population size, and we'll use n pred to indicate the predator population size. So just as in the logistic equation, we're going to express the instantaneous growth rate of either the predator or the prey as this dndt term. And remember, that's the instantaneous rate of change, or in other words, the slope of the growth curve for that population at any time. For the prey, this is going to be the dn prey dt term, okay? And that's on the left of the equal sign. So in the equation, the growth term for the prey is pretty much identical to that of the original logistic equation, and it depends on r, the intrinsic rate of increase for the prey. So the r n prey would simply be an exponential kind of growth term there. Again, this the little r, the intrinsic rate of increase, is determined by the difference between the births and deaths of the prey. On the right hand side, there after the minus sign, is the damping term. This is where we model the effect of the predator density on the consumption of the prey. That is, in other words, this is sort of the prey mortality term. So here on the left, we have the growth term, and that's going to be for prey growth. Again, the Rn prey term. And then on the right is our damping term. Okay, and this is going to account for prey mortality. So how should you think about this damping term? Well, look at the n prey times n pred term. So this gives us, if you multiply the number of prey times the number of predators, okay, you can think of this as the total possible number of pairwise encounters between a predator and a prey that could potentially occur between them, okay? And so for every one of those interactions, of course, there's a possibility that when they encounter one another, the predator would actually consume the prey, okay? And so, of course, here's where we get prey mortality. So C, this C term, is a constant, and it's a rate that determines what proportion of the encounters between a predator and a prey actually results in a capture of prey by a predator, okay? So little r is the prey growth rate, n prey and ed pred, those are the population size respectively for prey and predator, and c is the prey capture rate. So let's take a look at the predator model now. For the predator, we have the same basic organization. On the left, we have the dn pred dt term, and again, that is the instantaneous rate of change for the predator, or the slope of the predator growth curve. And on the left, we have the growth term for the predator model, and on the right, we have the damping term, and that is where predator mortality comes in. So notice that the growth term for the predator differs from the logistic equation. In the logistic equation, right, we had it was Rn, okay? Instead, the predator growth term in this predator model here depends upon the ability of the predator to consume the prey, right? So the assumption is here that the more prey there are, because they're a food source, the more predators they will be. So this is going to be a term that converts the number of prey that are around as a resource for the predators into predator numbers. Okay, so let's take a little let's sort of unpack that a little bit. So in the model, this is achieved by using the same damping term as in the prey model. In other words, you can see that C times N prey times N pred. All right. So again, that's simply the number of possible encounters between a predator and a prey. When we multiply it by C, the prey capture rate, that's how many prey are captured for every encounter between a predator and prey. But we add a birth rate term, B, to that, and that's the predator birth rate per prey captured, okay? So in other words, that's the number of predators that would be added through births for each prey that is captured by a predator, right? So it's a birth rate, but it's based on a birth rate of the predator, that is, but it's based on the number of prey that they have captured, okay? So the idea here is that the birth rate of the predator is fundamentally determined by the number of prey captured, okay? And that's going to cause a growth in the predator population. Of course, a decline in the number of prey would reduce the number of captures and therefore the birth rate of the predator and so forth. Okay, looking at the damping term on the right here, for the predator, that's simply predator mortality is how it's modeled in the Lotka-Volterra equation. And for this, in this model, it's given by D, which is just simply a mortality rate, okay? So when considered together, the predator and prey models interact to produce an interdependent and cyclic oscillation of predator and prey. So let's take a look at that. So this simple graph depicts a predator-prey oscillation that would be predicted by the Lotka-Volterra model. Notice that the prey in blue always leads the predator curve. Okay, so that's important, and we'll all be referring to that here and there throughout. So that is, the predator curve lags behind the prey curve. Okay, and so what this means is that increases in prey numbers, and prey, of course, are food for predators, will cause an increase in the number of predators. That is, the predators will have more encounters with the prey that result in captures, thinking of it in terms of the Lotka-Volterra model. More captures means more food for the predator, and of course then their population size will increase as a result. Again, note that there's a lag in the predators, for the predator's response, because it takes time for the predator population to respond through reproduction to any increase in prey numbers. It's going to be, you know, tightly linked, of course, mathematically, but there's always going to be this lag of the predator behind the prey numbers. As the numbers of predators increase, more prey are consumed, and so the predator's food source becomes limiting. When the prey become limiting, of course, prey captures decrease and the predator population declines. As the prey population declines, of course, so too does the predator population. When the predator population declines, the prey population, of course, can increase again because there's reduced mortality due to predation, and so on. So you can see how this creates a cyclic oscillation between predator numbers and prey numbers. So let's take a look at this, but in a little bit of a different way, okay? Knowing the conditions under which the predator and prey populations will increase, decrease, or remain stable, like we just talked about, at least increase and decrease. We haven't talked about stability yet, but that's what we're going to be talking about now. Will help us understand why predator and prey populations can sometimes cycle. So what we're going to do is we're going to plot out the numbers of predator and prey against one another. Okay, and when we do this, we can depict the growth trajectories of each population with respect to the other. Okay, in these graphs, the number of prey are on the x-axis and predators on the y. Okay, so let's start with the left graph. So if we draw a horizontal line, and this line defined by dn prey dt equals zero, it's a horizontal line at the number of predators that gives us a stable prey population. We call this the equilibrium isoline, or the zero growth isoline for the prey population, Below this line, there are relatively few predators, right? So if you look, the y-axis is showing us the number of predators. So when we are below this prey isocline, there are few predators, and so the prey population should increase. Okay, so this is indicated by the arrow below the line showing the prey population growing. Above the zero growth isoline, the prey population size should decrease because predators are removing them faster than they can reproduce. So we're above that prey isocline, and so prey numbers should decrease. So let's take a look now at the predation isoline. On the right graph, if we draw a vertical line at the number of prey that will cause the predator population to be stable. And again, if we set dn pred dt to zero, that means that our predator population is stable, We call this the equilibrium isocline or zero growth isocline for the predator population, So any combination of predator and prey that falls in the region to the right of this line, allows the predator population to increase because there's an increased abundance of prey to consume, So here on the right, the increase in predators is indicated by the arrow in the right-hand region. So in this region above that dn pred dt isocline, where we have a lot of prey, we're going to get an increase in the number of predators. And that's shown by that arrow. To the left, of course, where we have few prey, in other words, few resources for the predator population, we would expect the predator population to decrease because there's not enough prey available. Okay, so we're below the predator isocline here. Okay, so from this previous slide, if we actually combine the two isocline graphs for the predators and the prey, and consider the trajectories of both of them simultaneously, we can make predictions about how each population will change in the number of individuals in response to the other, and with respect to these isoclines, okay, that we've created. So this is shown in this graph here. Again, on the x-axis, we have the number of prey. On the y-axis, number of predators. Okay, so we're looking at the two different populations together. I've drawn the isoclines in, the dn pred dt of 0, the predator isocline and the prey isocline. And you'll see four quadrants. Okay, so let's talk about each one of those. In this form, when we combine those two graphs together, we call this a joint population trajectory because it's going to show us what the trajectory of the two populations is based on our isoclines and what is going to be happening with regard to the growth of the predator and prey populations. So let's start in the lower right region here. Okay. Before that, let me talk about this point here, okay? This is referred to as the joint equilibrium point, okay? So this is the point where the predator isocline and the prey isocline intersect. In other words, this is sort of the global equilibrium point. This is the point where the predator and prey populations both will be at equilibrium. In other words, neither increasing nor decreasing, okay? Again, we call that the joint equilibrium point. Okay, let's start in the lower right region in yellow, and we'll work our way around. So in this case, here, what we have is a relatively low number of predators. Okay, so when we have a low number of predators, we would expect the prey population to increase. As the prey population increases, of course, they provide more food for predators, and so we get an increase in the predator population as well. And this is depicted in this arrow that is increasing in both prey numbers and predator numbers. In the upper right quadrant, prey are still abundant enough that predators can increase, but the increasing number of predators starts to have a negative effect on the prey population and causes the prey population to decline. Therefore, the joint population trajectory moves upwards and to the left. In the upper left quadrant, the continued decline of the prey causes the predator population to decline because as prey numbers decrease, of course, that's a decrease in the food source for predators, okay? And so we would see the predator population decline. So the trajectory moves downward and to the left. In the lower left region, the continued decline of the predators allows the prey population to start decreasing, okay, because we have reduced predation on the prey, and so the prey population will begin to increase, and this causes the trajectory to move downwards and to the right, and of course this completes the cycle. Together, the trajectories in the four regions define a counterclockwise cycling of predator and prey populations. So this slide's simply a summary of what we just talked about for the joint population trajectory that we just went over. So again, in the lower right quadrant, we have an increase in the prey population allows an increase in the predator population. Moving upwards in the upper right quadrant, an increase in the predator population causes a decline in the prey population above that prey isocline. In the upper left quadrant, a decrease in the prey population, of course, is going to cause a corresponding decrease in the predator population. And in the lower left, a decrease in the predator population is going to allow an increase in the prey population. So this is the way the joint population trajectory is generally viewed. And when considered together, this cyclic movement of the numbers of prey with respect to the numbers of predators will create this sort of sinusoidal oscillation that we started with in the original sort of time series of looking at numbers of predator and prey over time. So just if we kind of link this joint population trajectory onto the Lotka-Volterra cycle over time, we can see how they fit together. And so each of these different quadrants, if we start with the lower right, as we did in the previous slides, if we sort of map that on to this population time series here, we can see that for this initial lower right quadrant, we're getting an increase in prey. And again, the number of prey is leading the predator curve. As prey populations increase, so too do we see an increase in the number of predators. As the number of predators increases, of course, we will begin to see a decline in the number of prey, and this is the upper right-hand quadrant of the joint population trajectory. In the upper left quadrant is where we see now that there's been a significant decline in the prey population, such that that's causing a corresponding decline in the predator population. And finally, in the lower left quadrant, we see that now the predator population numbers have fallen low enough to allow a rebound of the prey population, and so our cycle continues over again. As with all models, the Lotka-Volterra model is a simplification of nature. In particular, the Lotka-Volterra doesn't take account of several key factors that can influence predator-prey dynamics. For instance, it doesn't include time delays or density dependence. It also doesn't incorporate the real foraging behavior of most predators. In natural populations of predator and prey, there can be lags between changes in the number of predators and prey abundance. This means that the response of a predator population to increases in prey numbers often lags behind prey numbers. Likewise, the density of prey can influence the rate at which prey are consumed by predators. This kind of density-dependent feedback can create different kinds of responses of predators to their prey, and this can affect predator-prey dynamics. Finally, foraging behavior as well can play an important role. Predators not only need to spend time searching for and capturing prey, but once they've captured it, they have to actually handle the prey. So handling time is an important aspect that can influence predator-prey dynamics. Switching between different prey by a predator can also affect the interaction between predator-prey and therefore the dynamics of the two populations. So to get a more realistic picture of predator-prey dynamics and their interactions, we really need to consider what's referred to as functional and numerical responses of predators to prey abundance. So functional responses explain how the predator is responding to prey abundance. And so there are three different kinds of functional responses that have been recognized. Type 1, type 2, and type 3. So let's just take a look at each one of those, and then I'll give an example, and we'll talk about type 3 in a little bit more detail. So the first type here, type 1, shows that the response of a prey in terms of the number of prey consumed per predator as prey density increases. So it's pretty obvious that as the number of prey increases, so would the number of prey consumed by a predator. But there are different kinds of ways that response happens. Type 1 is essentially a linear increase in the rate of prey consumed. But at some point, the predators become saturated. And at all prey densities higher than a certain point, which is kind of the elbow of that curve there, the predator becomes satiated. And so there's no increase in the rate of prey consumed per predator. In a type 2 response, we have a similar kind of plateau where the predator becomes satiated, but the rate of prey consumed doesn't sharply stop, but it slows with increasing prey density. So we get a more gradual slowing of the rate of prey consumed by predators as prey density increases. This slowing is often related to more time required by the predator to handle the prey than to capture it. So let me just give you an example of a type 1. There are certain kinds of web-building spiders, and I think this example comes out of your book, that exhibit this kind of functional response. So they pretty much capture and consume, you know, an ever-increasing number of prey in their web as prey density increases. So their web is capturing, the more prey there are in the web, you know, the more it can consume. But at some point, the prey density increases to a point where the spider population becomes satiated. And so after that, they consume a constant number of prey per predator. In a type 2, an example might be between the interaction of wolves and caribou, which are the prey of the wolves. As the number of caribou increases, the number of caribou kills by wolves will increase as well, but eventually level off. And this is because the proportion of caribou killed per wolf is decreasing as caribou density increases. The higher the density of caribou, the smaller the proportion of caribou killed per wolf. Explained a little bit differently, we could look at it as that at very high caribou densities, wolves need little time to find prey, and so they can find and capture them very efficiently, but they spend almost all their time handling the prey after some level of prey density, and less time searching. So this results in sort of a slowing of the prey capture rate as prey density increases. So wolves ultimately then become satiated, and the total number of caribou kills reaches a plateau. In a type 3 functional response of the predator to prey densities, what we see is that initially there's a very low rate of prey consumed, low capture rates, basically, and consumption rates. It becomes more rapid as prey density increases, but then slows, and again at point where we get to satiation. And I'll give a more detailed example of this in a minute, but the point to keep in mind here with regard to all of these functional responses of predators to prey density is that whenever the prey population density increases and a predator can consume a higher proportion of those prey, the predator has the ability to regulate the growth of the prey population. And so this is how these functional responses can play out in different ways to influence predator and prey populations. So let's take a look now at what can cause low consumption rates at low prey densities. This is a type 3 response that I'm talking about. So there are several different factors that can cause low consumption rates when prey densities are low, and but that as density increases, that rate accelerates and then ultimately again plateaus, creating kind of this S-shaped response curve. One of them is habitat heterogeneity. And what this means is that if you imagine a habitat or an environment that has many different kinds of habitats where prey reside, and it's a fairly complex habitat, there might be many hiding places. And so these hiding places are plentiful at low prey densities, which means that predators have a harder time finding them, okay? But as prey density increases, those hiding places, those little niches, refuges for the prey, become occupied. And so predators have an easier time finding prey. So that's one way in which we could get a type 3 functional response. Learning is another. At low prey densities, predators have less experience with their prey, and so they are less proficient at capturing prey because perhaps they don't have a well-established search image. And a search image is simply a learned mental image that an organism has that helps in this case a predator locate that prey and capture that prey more effectively. So this can affect the functional response as well. Switching prey is also another way in which you can which we see a type 3 functional response. So this is a case where predators actually switch prey sources from prey that are rare to prey that are more abundant. And so this can also produce a type 3 functional response. So let's take a look at an example of that in particular, where there was a study done looking at prey switching by a predator. So this study, this is a study of predatory insects known as back swimmers. So these are predators, and researchers manipulated the proportion of different kinds of prey for back swimmers that they were exposed to. And so the prey that the predator could choose from in this study were either larval mayflies or isopods, okay? And so in this graph, what's being shown here is the percent of mayflies that were in the environment, okay, relative to the isopods. And on the y-axis, the percent of mayflies that were consumed by back swimmers as the percent of mayflies increased in the environment. So the red line shows the expected proportion of mayflies that would be predicted to be consumed by the predator if the predator's preference was not affected by the proportion of the abundance of mayflies relative to the isopods. And the blue line is the observed percentage. So when mayflies were rare in the environment, in other words, on the x-axis, that would be the left end of the x-axis, back swimmers, the predator in this case, consumed fewer mayflies than would have been expected based on their abundance alone. Okay, and so that's shown here by the observed line being lower than the expected line. But as the percent of mayflies increased in the environment, in other words, they became more common relative to the other possible prey item, the isopods. And this is shown as we move towards the right of that x-axis. The predator consumed more mayflies than was expected based on their abundance alone. And again, this is depicted in the graph by the observed line being higher than the expected line. So just to kind of summarize, the study manipulated the percent of available prey, and that's shown along the x-axis as percent mayflies in the environment. And when the mayflies were rare, we had a lower observed consumption of mayflies by the predators than expected. But at more common, when mayflies were common, the predator actually consumed more mayflies than expected. So the results suggest that back swimmers became more proficient at capturing and consuming mayflies when they were more abundant and less proficient at capturing them when they were less abundant. In other words, they improved their capture rate because they had more practice capturing the more abundant prey. When prey were rare, they had less practice and they were therefore less proficient at capturing them. And this was actually true regardless of which prey were more or less abundant, the mayflies or the isopods. So this is an example of a type 3 functional response. A numerical response of predators is another way in which predators can regulate prey numbers. And a numerical response is simply a change in the number of predators through population growth or movement of predators through immigration. Predator populations usually grow relatively slowly, but if prey populations become very high in a particular area, predators can actually move in very quickly from surrounding areas to take advantage of abundant prey populations. And so this can happen actually pretty quickly. Bay-breasted warblers are a good example. They're a small insectivorous bird of eastern North America. And during outbreaks of the spruce budworm, as shown here, this is the picture there of that forest with all those red trees. Those are that is not the fall colors. That's actually due to a spruce budworm outbreak. During outbreaks of this spruce budworm, populations of the warbler are known to increase dramatically. In most years, the warbler populations live at pretty low densities, around 25 breeding pairs of birds per square kilometer. But during times of outbreaks of the spruce budworm, the warblers can congregate in areas where the spruce budworm is abundant in enormous numbers. And so this graph shows a depiction of the correspondence between spruce budworm numbers during the outbreaks and the warblers correspondingly congregating in areas where they have very high spruce budworm population sizes. As a result of this rapid numerical response by the predatory warblers, it has the potential to reduce prey densities quite dramatically, and therefore to regulate, in this case, regulate spruce budworm abundance, but also the potential for regulation of any particular prey species that becomes very abundant in a particular area. Okay, I'm just going to wrap up with this slide. If you recall from our lecture on population regulation, moose on Isle Royale in Lake Ontario coexist with wolves on the island and have been studied for many, many years. These studies have led to some long-term data sets that shed some interesting light on predator-prey dynamics for these two species. So I want to just revisit for a moment our moose and wolves. So first off, what's shown here is the moose population dynamic that we talked about. And I might have mentioned that at some point in the history of this island, there was an ice bridge that had formed, and several wolves crossed that ice bridge and established a population of wolves on the island. After that point, of course, because wolves prey on moose, there has been a long-term dynamic between moose populations and wolves. If you recall, we came up with a couple of hypotheses about the dynamics of the moose population on this island, but what I want to do is add the wolf population to this graph so you can see what the population of wolves is doing corresponding to the same time frame as the moose population. The first thing to notice, of course, is that if you look at the increase in the moose population through sort of the late 60s into the 70s and then towards 1980, is that it increased and declined. And adding the wolf population information to this graph pretty strongly suggests that it's not a decline, that the moose population didn't decline due to, say, overshooting its carrying capacity and depleting its food resource, which in this case it's an herbivore and consumes balsam fir, but that there's a good chance that an increase in wolf predation could have been responsible. And in fact, the research that's been conducted on this island supports that claim. So this decline in the moose population is due to wolf predation that drove down the moose population. So here we do see an indication that we have this somewhat cyclic interaction between moose and wolves. In other words, somewhat consistent with the Lotka-Volterra type of predator-prey dynamic. Here is, at this point, we see that the wolf population has increased dramatically, perhaps due to increasing numbers of moose that allowed that population of wolves to increase to quite a high level. What we know from the research is that in 1980, a parvovirus swept through the wolf population. And it did so at a time when their population density was very high, as indicated in the graph. And corresponding to that, their food supply, in other words, moose, was very low. At this point, they became weakened. In fact, the researchers at the time noted that there was a canine parvovirus that was essentially responsible for killing about 80% of the pups. It was also causing some gastrointestinal damage and dehydration in the wolf population. And so this caused a very dramatic decline in the wolf population. There was a bit of an uptick, but then the wolf population stayed rather low between, say, 1985 and 1995. During that time, of course, you can see that the moose population began to increase. The research also indicates that in just sort of mid-1980s or so, that wolf decline that you can see there was probably due to inbreeding depression. In other words, this wolf population, having established on the island from a very small number of initial colonists, in other words, there was a founder effect going on here, right? So the population had very low genetic diversity, and so individuals were basically breeding with very, very close relatives. And so this created inbreeding depression and caused a number of genetic problems in the wolf population. This was actually relieved a bit by some wolves that had immigrated onto the island around that time from Canada. We see here also, and I think we talked about this when we talked about population regulation, that at this very high level of population of the moose, there was this dramatic decline in the moose population. This was probably due to a dramatic decline in balsam fir, again, the food source for the moose. Several hard winters that preceded that were probably responsible for this dramatic decline. Here, as I mentioned, that decline in the wolf population probably due to inbreeding depression. So I think what you can see here is that there's quite a complexity of environmental factors, interactions that are going on, in this case between a predator and the prey population, that have a very strong and dramatic impact on population dynamics in natural populations.